All right, hello everyone. We are going to be taking a look at section 10.1, estimating means with confidence. So the learning targets for today will be to determine the critical value for calculating a C confidence interval, a C percent confidence interval for a population mean using a table or technology, state and check the random 10% and large slash normal sample conditions for constructing a confidence interval for a population, and construct and interpret a confidence interval for a population mean. Now, a lot of the ideas will be similar to chapter 8 when we talked about confidence intervals for proportions. There will be one wrinkle in the equation, which you'll see here in a second, but you'll start to see the parallels, and there should be some, but you want to make sure you know what the difference is. So you don't make the same mistake. All right, so right off the bat, we know that the formula for a confidence interval for population proportion is p hat plus or minus z star times the square root of p hat times 1 minus p hat over n. Or another way you could say is it's the point statistic or point estimate plus or minus the critical value, which is our z star, times the standard deviation of the statistic. So the big thing is that, hey, square root of p hat times 1 minus p hat over n is going to be that standard deviation for us. Z star is our critical value, and our p hat was our statistic. Now, you probably actually could have guessed this using just a little bit of background information, but for confidence intervals, for population means, it's going to be the same exact thing. Instead of p hat, we're now going to have the statistic x bar. So that z star, and then this is just our new standard deviation based on our x bar, so sigma over square root of n. And this is called a one sample z interval for a population mean. Now, before you get all jumpy and excited about it, unfortunately, we won't use that formula all that much, because if we don't know mu, which is obvious, that's why we're doing a confidence interval. If we knew what mu was, we wouldn't have to do a confidence interval, because we'd already know what mu is. We're not trying to estimate an interval that captures mu. And so the case is, if we don't really know mu, we will hardly ever know sigma, because you kind of need to know mu to help you find sigma. So we won't use that formula, but we'll see a new one coming up here in a little bit. The big problem you want to say, all right, well, why can't we just use sigma or the sample standard deviation instead and still have this formula and just swap out sigma for the sample standard deviation? Well, couple problems with that. Right off the bat, so we've done something similar to this where we are trying to, we just do a bunch of confidence intervals and see how many capture the true mean. So here's an example, and we would expect if this is a 99% confidence interval for 99% of them to capture the true mean. Unfortunately, that doesn't happen. And if you look at this one instance right here, this one little red one, they make a little note that even though x bar was really close, and not, it wasn't that far from you, the interval missed because the value of s of x was so much smaller than sigma that it didn't allow a far enough interval to capture the true mean. So even if your x bar is really good, you might not capture it just because your sample standard deviation is way too small. And so you see here, well, 99% confidence interval, if you count these up, you only get 92.5% out of 1,000 intervals. 1,000, quite a few, right? Because we're talking about confidence level. It does have to do with if you take many, many confidence intervals, how many do you expect? I would say that 1,000 falls inside that many, many category. And so we're not hitting our confidence level. We're not hitting 99%, which is a problem. So to achieve this 99% capture rate, we need to multiply by a larger critical value. And basically for this exact reason, right? Our x bar is pretty decent, but our sigma of x, or our s of x, our sample standard deviation is so small. In order to allow us to get a larger interval, we would have to multiply by a larger statistic. I'm gonna go back to that page for a second, right? If I want this part of the equation, right, the plus or minus actually makes the interval to be larger, I need to make this number bigger to make it bigger. Okay. So, to estimate mu, when sigma is unknown, we are actually going to use something called our T-star critical value. So instead of using a Z-star, we're going to use a T-star. And you might say, okay, what does that mean? Well, the critical value T-star has the same interpretation as a Z-star. It measures how many standard deviations we need to extend from a point estimate to get the desired level of confidence. We specify a specific T-distribution by the degrees of freedom. And we'll talk about that here in a little bit. But here's an example of three pictures. So purple is the normal distribution. It's the tallest one and also has the lowest tails. T with a 2 degrees of freedom, you see, is pretty significantly smaller and larger up on the tails. And T with 9 degrees of freedom falls in between those two. So T distributions in general have more area in the tails than the standard deviation. So some people like to call them like fattier tails because there's just more data there. As you might guess, as that degrees of freedom goes up, this T distribution is going to start to look more and more like the standard normal curve, which I think should make sense here in a little bit when you talk about what degrees of freedom are. But for now, that is what our T star is. So a couple of problems here. So what critical value T star from table B should be used in constructing a confidence interval for a population mean in which the following settings? A 95% confidence interval based on an SRS of n equals 12. So it doesn't explicitly state it, but when we're talking about degrees of freedom, the way you find degrees of freedom is degrees of freedom minus, or the sample size minus 1 equals degrees of freedom. So degrees of freedom 11, that's because our sample size is 12, so 12 minus 1 gives us our degrees of freedom. And then we're going to go right into our table, find out what probability of P we want. Remember, if we want a 95% confidence interval, that means 5% is going to be in the tails. But if we're looking for one specific tail, we got to divide that 5% in half. So 2.5% or 0.025. And we get it equal to here. We can verify that on a calculator. If we go to stat calc. Second distribution, and I'm going to go to see we have inverse normal. I'm going to keep going down. Is there inverse T? Hold up. So unfortunately, it does not appear that the old school calculators have this, but if you're on a newer calculator, like I just did on my own with the TI-84, there should be, right underneath inverse norm, there's probably inverse T, and your inputs are going to be the probability, so in this case 0.025, comma, the degrees of freedom, so 11, and then you get it out. Obviously, since this doesn't come up on a calculator, I would suggest just using the table that will be given to you. Part B asked a 90% confidence interval with a random sample of 48 observations. So here, as you can see, there would be a ton of T distributions, just like there's a ton of normal distributions depending on the mean and standard deviation. So your book or your table might not give you every single possible degrees of freedom. So here it says 48, and they are going to suggest using 40. So it's not a bad idea to round down because it'll be a more conservative estimate. It'll give you more data from a fattier tail, the lower the degrees of freedom. So it's not a bad idea to use to round down in this case. And then since there's a 90% confidence interval, we are looking for 5% in each tail, and therefore we would get our T star to be 168.84. So this is the exact calculations. For some reason, my old calculator doesn't have it. But you go inverse T, the probability that you want in the tail, comma, the degrees of freedom, and you get out your T star. Now it does come up negative, and that should make sense, right? Because that gives you like your t star or your t value of a normal curve. And since we're looking for the bottom left percent, the bottom left one, that is going to be a negative value. But it doesn't matter because our formula is plus or minus. So it doesn't matter if our z star is positive or negative. We're going to have both a positive and a negative value. So you can report just t star is 2.201. All right. Conditions for estimating mu. These should look very familiar, especially the first two. The second one or the third one, maybe a little different. But first things first, the random condition is crucial for doing inference. If the data does not come from a random sample, you cannot draw conclusions from a larger population. I think the easiest way to understand this is comparing it to an experiment, right? If you don't use random assignment, then the conclusions that you make can only be made for that group in there. You need to have random assignment to ensure that you can draw these conclusions to a wider population, which is the whole point, because we're trying to find it for a mean, for our mu, our population mean. So we kind of need the randomness here. The second one is if you're sampling without replacement, the 10% condition ensures that our formula for standard deviation is approximately correct. So basically, if you're less than 10% and you're not changing the population from trial to trial, and therefore you can kind of, you'll be okay using our formula that we have. And lastly, it's what we've been calling as our large counts, or slash the normal in this case, to ensure it is appropriate to use a t distribution to calculate the t star. You need to make sure your sample either comes from a normal distribution or the sample is large enough. And we'll talk about what that means. So random 10% should be pretty self-explanatory. We've been doing these two for a while now. The normal large sample is a little bit different. You need to first, it's any one of these three. So if the population is a normal distribution, you're good to go and say that the distribution is going to be approximately normal. If the sample size is larger than n, then we're also good. This should sound familiar from the central limit theorem back, I believe, in chapter 7, when we're talking about our sampling distribution needing to be larger than 30 so that regardless of the shape of the population, our sampling distribution will still be approximately normal. And lastly, probably the least common, but important to note in case the first two fail. If the population distribution has unknown shape and n is less than 30, you can use a graph of the sample data to assess the normality of the population. Basically, as long as it's not skewed heavily, you could still kind of get away with it as long as you have a graph there to help you. But I do give a hint, do not use t procedure if the graph shows strong skewness or outliers. So if the sample standard deviation, the sample distribution is skewed or has outliers, you want to stay away from concluding and doing a t test or a t interval, not a t test, but a t interval. So here's a problem: we have to determine if the normal slash large sample condition is met in each of the following settings. To estimate average GPA of students at your high school, you randomly select 50 students. Here's a histogram of the GPAs. And now you might say, is this normal or not? Well, it does not matter because the sample size is 50, which is larger than 30. So we're good right off the bat. We don't have to worry about looking at the graph. Or B, how much force does it take to pull wood apart? The stem plot shows the force in pounds required to pull a piece of Douglas fir apart for each of 20 random selected pines. So nowhere in this problem does it tell us that the distribution is normal, and 20 is less than 30. So we should be have our like caution eyes on right now, thinking about, ooh, can we actually do this? When I'm looking at the stem plot, it does look like there's some skewness, right? I got two pulling way low, and a lot of our bulk is to the right. So I would say no, the stem plot is strongly skewed to the left with possible low outliers, and n is less than 30. So the sampling distribution is not approximately normal, and I can no longer complete this task. Here's the third one. Suppose you want to estimate the mean SAT math score at a large high school. Here's a box plot of the SAT math scores for a random sample of 20 students. So notice again, hey, 20 is less than 30, so we need to proceed with caution. I'm going to look here, and I can see, hey, my middle 25 and my middle 50 is pretty symmetric, right? This mean is pretty much in between these two numbers. So it is fairly symmetric. It's not too skewed to the right. I know that this has a long tail, but that could just be one point out here, and most of the data could be around here. So even though n is less than 30, the box plot is only moderately skewed to the right, and there are no outliers. So we can continue on with this. And here is an AP test tip, just so that we are aware. If a question on the AP statistics exam asks you to construct and interpret a confidence interval, all the conditions should be met. However, you are still required to state the conditions and show evidence that they are met, including a graph if the sample size is small and the data are provided. So in this case, here's the sample size is created, or the data is here. So we can create a box plot, or a dot plot if you like, and then you can see, hey, is it skewed? Are there outliers, or are we okay to proceed? So you always want to check that and check your conditions first before you go on with the problem. Okay. If it ever asks you to construct a confidence interval, you have to follow the four-step plan. This is probably the third or fourth time you're hearing this now. But the four-step plan is state, plan, do, conclude. So state the parameter you want to estimate and the confidence level. Plan means to identify the appropriate inference method or what test you're doing and check the conditions. Do is to do the calculations. And then conclude, you have to interpret your interval in the context of the problem. So here is actually the formula we will almost always use, unless they tell us that the population standard deviation is blank. We are going to use a T star. So a C percent confidence interval for an unknown mu is X bar plus or minus T star times sample standard deviation divided by square root of n. And here you have it in writing, T distribution with n minus 1 degrees of freedom. So the degrees of freedom is always 1 less than the sample size. So we have a problem. You can pause it and read it here for a second. They ask us to construct and interpret a 95% confidence interval for the mean number of books read in the previous 12 months, and then to conclude and make an argument based on our confidence interval. So first thing first, we got to state we're 95% confidence interval for mu, the true mean number of books read by all American adults in the previous 12 months. So I get my confidence interval, I get my mean. Plan, what test are you doing? So a one sample T interval for mu, we had no idea what sample with the population sigma was. So we can't use Z star, so this is going to be a T interval. And then our three conditions, random, well, there's random samples of 1,520 American adults. 10%, this is definitely less than 10% of all American adults, right? Because that would mean that there's only 15,000 American adults, there's certainly more than that. And then normal size large sample, the sample size is large and is equal to 1,520, which is more than 30. So we are good to proceed. The do phase. So it's nice to kind of refresh your brain of what you have. You have X bar is 12 books, S sub X is 18 books, degrees of freedom. In our table, right, this is a huge number of n. So we are going to use what we have, and our table gives us degrees of freedom with 1,000. From there, I can calculate my T star, and I just want to show this for a second. Second distribution, inverse norm, 0.025. So as you can see here, my normal distribution is 1.96. I'm here 1.962. So as the degrees of freedom get larger and larger, so as our sample size gets bigger and bigger, we start to get closer and closer to a normal distribution. So just a little bit of an overlap there, but we are still using a Z star, and we need to use a Z star or else we will lose points. Okay, so I'm going to plug in my information, 12, lose my statistic, plus or minus T star times S of X over square root of N to get my interval here. All right, I'm then going to conclude. We are 95% confident that the interval from blank to blank captures mu, the true mean number of books reading, read by all American adults in the previous 12 months. I just said blank or blank because that's kind of the template, but you should fill it in with the interval for obvious reasons. Part B asks, in 2011, Pew reported that American adults read an average of 14 books in the previous 12 months. Does your interval from Part A provide convincing evidence that the 2016 mean is different than 14? Explain. Yes, it does give evidence that 14 is that it's different than 14. Since 14 is not in the interval, it's not a plausible value for the mean number of books read by all American adults in the previous 12 weeks or 12 months. You can kind of answer however you need, but as long as you get the idea that 14 is not in the interval and that a confidence interval captures plausible values for the true mean. Here's another example that you can kind of read. It's a little bit different format, so you might want to pause this video, and I would actually plug this data into your calculator, into the edit. I've done it here already, but I would do it just so you know how to do a problem like this, one where it doesn't give us the mean and standard deviation and such, or the X bar. So pause, read the problem, type this into your calculator, and then we'll start here up again. So press play again. I'm going to go over to tests, and now it is a T, but not a T test. It's a T interval, so I keep tabling down, T interval, and then I see data or stats. So if I knew what like my X bar and my S of X is, I could do type it into stat. Or if I have my data, I can type it into L1, say the frequency is just 1, each point is only 1, and then my confidence level is 0.9. And I'm going to press calculate. Now, this will give you the answer, but think about it. If you just type this in, you're missing all the state, you're missing all the calculations, or all the planning, and you're missing the conclusion. So, which one's better to do? Obviously by hand, because you're not going to miss out on a lot of things. If you just did the calculator, you're going to get a fourth of the points that you need. So it's important to understand how to do it by hand. Use the calculator as a reference after. So I'm going to state my confidence level and my true mean in context. My plan, one sample T for mu, random, good, 10%, good. Here's the normal distribution part that is important that you wouldn't have even thought about if you just jumped to this. N is equal to 20, which is less than 30. Nowhere did it say that my population mean was that the distribution was normal. So I need to proceed with caution. If I draw the dot plot, I see there isn't a lot of skewness, no real outliers, so I'm able to proceed with the test. But if I did not draw this graph and I did not write a statement saying the dot plot does not show strong skewness or outliers, you will lose points. Okay, you have to state all of your conditions. To do, all right, I can get my X bar, I can get my S of X, and maybe you don't even do the T test. Maybe you just go stat, calc, one var stat, and if you do one var stat, you'll also get your X bar and your S of X, and you can do degrees of freedom as N minus 1, find your T statistic, and go from there. So you don't even need to do the T interval. You could calculate it all by hand. And then we conclude we are 90% confident that the interval from 292.32 to 320.32 captures mu, the true mean tension in the entire batch of video terminal produced. All right, another AP exam tip. It is not enough just to make a graph of the data on your calculator when assessing normality. You must sketch it on your paper, so you must show the graph also. And you must write a sentence to describe it. Describe that there is not strong skewness, or else you would lose points as well. So you need both those. And lastly, to round up this video, we're talking about margin of error. This should be familiar. It's going to be very similar to Chapter 8 with what margin of error does. So margin of error is affected by the confidence level, the sample size, and the sample standard deviation. It does not compensate for bias. I'm going to repeat that. Margin of error does not compensate for bias or bad sampling or whatever. It only accounts for sampling variability, right? So what exactly, how exactly does margin of error change? As you decrease the sample size, the margin of error decreases as sample size increases. And that makes sense because this formula, n is in the denominator. So as n gets bigger, you are going to make the standard deviation smaller, which makes the margin of error smaller. The margin of error is proportional to 1 over n, so quadrupling the sample size will cut the margin of error in half, assuming everything else stays the same, but we've seen a couple problems with that already. The margin of error will be larger for higher confidence levels. This makes sense, right? It would be wider interval if our t star is larger or if our confidence level is larger, because we want to be more confident. So if I go from 95% confident to 99% confident, if I'm going to be more confident, I want to have a wider interval so I capture more numbers. So I have a higher probability of capturing the true mean. And then what I said, margin of error does not account for bias in the data collection process, only sampling variability. All right, and to wrap it up, here are your three learning targets that you should accomplish from watching this video.